Welcome back to my channel. I'm Brian Kafke, and we're continuing the series Master Databricks and Open Source Apache Spark. In this lesson, we'll be doing PySpark, a deeper dive into user-defined functions. In particular, we're going to be talking about coding pandas UDFs, user-defined functions. In my last video, I talked about specific user-defined functions, and when we talk about pandas UDFs, we're talking about specifically ones that are called series to series, iterator of series to iterator of series, iterator of multiple series to iterator of series. And one that we're not going to cover in this video, but's also included as part of that set, is series to scalar. Now, these UDFs are vectorized. And the whole point of coding a user-defined function is you need to do some special logic, generally a transformation. You want it to run in parallel. In other words, you're going to push this code out to the node so that it'll run extremely quickly in parallel and leveraging the scale-out architecture of Spark. There are certain requirements for you to code these so they'll perform correctly. Now, the pandas UDF is a rewriting of the syntax that had been defined in previous versions of Spark. The new one, pandas UDFs, are actually as of Spark 3.0. So a lot of it is really doing the same thing that was being done before, but the coding has changed and you need to know about that. So this will be specific to Apache Spark 3.0 and later. You'll be able to find this notebook by following the link in the description below this video. Now, as I mentioned, in this particular lesson, it is specific to the version of Spark you're using. Spark 3.0 has been still pretty new, so you may not have it, but if you're using Databricks, you're probably okay. If you're using a relatively recent version of the Databricks driver, etc., you should be good. But you can check it just by doing sc.version. And notice this is a Python notebook. So everything we're doing generally will be Python unless we code specifically a different magic. All right, we can see here we've got 3.0.1. So we're good to go as far as the Spark version. Other thing we want to do, and again, if you haven't seen my prior video to this, I strongly recommend you do because it gives you the kind of conceptual background of what we're doing. But to get good performance, we want to enable Apache Arrow. Now, generally, if you're using a new driver, a new cluster in Databricks, you're okay. If you're on Apache Spark, you're going to have to check this out and make sure you get it enabled. But you can check it by just looking at spark.conf.get and then just passing in the given name of any parameter. In this case, the spark.sqlexecution.arrow.enabled. If I run that and it says true, then it's enabled. Like we can see in this case it is enabled. If it's not enabed, we can run the same call, only this time instead of get, we're going to say set, and we just pass in true. Now, Apache Arrow is very important because what it does is it eliminates the need when going between different services, in this case, Python pandas, to the JVM on a node. It eliminates the need to convert data between them. Instead, it establishes both of them on the same data format, which is Apache Arrow's format, which is great because Arrow is an extremely efficient way to store data. Now, there is another thing in here, and I don't know if it's an issue in all cases or not. Generally in Databricks, again, I don't think you'll have an issue, but if you're using Spark, you may have to take a look at this. And I found that this issue potentially on this link here. So if you get this notebook, you can follow that. But the author talks about the potential that you're not actually getting the optimal conversion to and from pandas into Arrow all the time. You can check this by checking another parameter, spark sql execution arrow.pyspark.enabled, and check and see if that's, in this case, we're setting it to true. If we want to check it, we can say get, but I'm just going to set it to true. And then here I can see that if it's enabled or not, make sure it really took. This doesn't apply to all things you're doing, but it will apply to a lot of different cases where you're converting between data frames to the Java virtual machine. Another thing I saw, and again, I don't know how commonly this is a problem, but I'm putting it in just to be complete, but there's the potential, according to that same blog, that if there's an error when running your code, Apache Arrow usage can actually turn off. And they call this setting Spark SQL execution arrow PySpark fallback.enabled. So we want to set that to true so that if there is an error, it will still stick with the Apache Arrow format. And there's another link here that talks about pandas and PyArrow, which is part of how this whole thing works. And there's a link you can follow. But one of the things it talks about is when you're doing this, you want to make sure you have Pandas 0.0, 0.24, 0.2, and Pi arrow should be at least 15.1 here, okay? So 0.15.1. You can use higher versions, but you don't want to use lower versions. So first I'm going to import pandas as PD, and then I'm going to use PD show versions to check out what version of pandas I have running on my cluster. In my case, I have Python 3.75, which is great, and pandas 1.0.1. So I'm okay, I think, with that. It's more recent than required, but I think we'll be fine, and I haven't had any issues. To check out the PyArrow version, you want to import PyArrow, and then just display PyArrow.__version__. So we're good to go. Now, as always, we're going to just pull some data in from one of our tables to make this easy to jump in and get started. If you're jumping in this video and you have not already loaded the tables that we did in a prior video, I'll put a link below and you can go back and do that. But one of the tables we had loaded, I believe was video 9, was Factor Internet Sales. So I'll point you back to that video and you can do that if you haven't already. So what we're doing in this is just going to quickly create a new data frame, SPDF_sales. We're going to first change the context to the database we created, which is AW Project. We created that earlier. And then we're going to run Spark SQL. We're only going to pull a few columns in, right? We're going to get the customer key, the order date key, sales amount, and total product cost from Factor Internet Sales. And I'm limiting the rows to 10 because I'm not really trying to demonstrate the performance at this point, just to demonstrate how to do the coding. And I'm extending this with the method drop NA so that if there's any NA values in this, it will not put that row out. So we'll just get 10 clean rows. So again, we're just going to create a quick data frame here that we can then use to run our code with. And we can get a quick display here. We're just going to display the data frame, which again only has a handful of rows, but we can take a look at that. We can see we've got customer key, order date key, which is really just the date formatted as an integer, the sales amount, and the total product cost. So the first type of UDF we're going to create is called the series to series. It's a very simple function to code, and you'll notice the syntax is very easy. It's pretty much just a regular function, except with a few nuances specific to using PySpark. As usual, we're going to import pandas as PD, but then we're going to be importing from PySpark SQL functions something called pandas_UDF. Now we're going to use that because we're going to be prefixing or putting a decorator on our function, which is pandas_UDF, and then we're telling it what is the data type to be returned from our function. So that's an important thing for Spark to know because it can make things more performant if it understands the data type. This is one of the great challenges with using Python when you need a lot of performance and you want to optimize things, because Python is a dynamically typed language and therefore it does not know the types. It'll let you change them on the fly. It doesn't restrict you in any way. But that creates a problem for Spark, which is trying to organize the data in the most efficient way possible. So by doing this decorator, you're actually altering the function so that it will define the data type to be returned. A relatively new feature added to Python is the idea of type hints. A type hint is a way to get some of the functionality of strict data typing in the Python language. But it isn't 100% because the maintainers of Python do not want to implement strict data typing in the language. So instead, they're adding something where it's saying we're telling you what should be going in or what we suggest, which is a hint, with the parameter. And you can see it here because when you see this sort of dash arrow looking thing, the dash greater than sign, that's pointing to a type hint. But here we're just saying PD series. The real information of what it's going to be looking for is here, the decorator where it says it's a double. So it's really expecting to send back a double. So the PySpark is expecting that it will be able to send back a double as part of this function. So it's not expecting to be trying to return a string or something. And that's kind of a change. So this decorator is not an optional thing. This is the new way of coding it that not only makes it more standardized than older ways of coding the similar type of functionality, but it's leveraging the new type hints to make it cleaner, more Pythonic, more elegant. It's also, of course, more readable. You can easily look at this function and you can see, okay, I know it's going to give back a series, and the decorator is telling me it's going to be a double. And then we have a function, which of course our function name is just margin%_UDF, and then our parameters. So we're going to be passing in sales amount, And then that's going to be a series. So you can kind of see the parameters here. It's like a dictionary type thing. PD series we're passing in. And then we're going to be passing in a series, which is going to be the product cost. And that's a series. So we can pass in two series in this function. And we could code this with additional series if we like. And we're going to be returning a series, PD series. And here you can see really all the logic is going to return is just, it's going to take the sales amount, subtract the product cost, and divide the result by sales amount. And it's really just trying to create a sort of rough gross margin on the sales. So it's giving you a percentage of basically how much of our sales is profit versus the cost of the product. And we can test it immediately because we can just take our data frame, SPDF underscore sales, and use the select method, pass in the two columns that we want to use. We can just put those in double quotes and then call our function. And we can easily call that by just using our data frame. And we'll use the select method. And we'll ask to see the columns that we're going to be passing in so that we can compare the results. So we're going to be asking to see sales amount and total product cost. And then we're going to be calling our function here, which is margin underscore percent underscore UDF. And we're passing in sales amount and total product cost. So we're really passing in columns from our data frame. All right, very simple to do. And it's very, as you can see, very easy to use. And then we can just do a show so we'll see the results. So let's run this. And you can see it did what we asked. It's giving us the sales amount, the total product cost, and then it's giving us the ratio or the percentage. So this tells us sort of a rough profit margin we're getting. And notice it actually takes the whole function call and makes that the column heading. So it's not ideal. I'll show you how you can replace that a little later on. You can see we've got like, okay, a 39% profit margin here, 43%, 40% here. So we now have a way that we can do a distributed calculation. We can push this function out to the cluster nodes and it will work in parallel. And I do want to emphasize that this is not completely new, but it is a sort of new syntax and improvements being made around how we do pandas UDFs. The next type of function you can code, I want to show you how you can do some initialization logic. So to do that, I'm going to broadcast a variable. And when you broadcast a variable, what you're really doing is you're taking some piece of data and you want to push it out to all of the nodes to make it available. Sometimes you can just do, as we know, we can do joins and all kinds of things, but that can cause what's called a shuffle. And when you do that, that's a lot of overhead. It can take a long time. So broadcasts are a nice way that when we don't have a huge amount of data we need to share across the nodes, this is a way to just make it available locally on each node. So we're using SC because SC is the Databricks Spark context. It creates a Spark context called SC as a variable, and that has a method called broadcast. And what I want to do here is I'm going to pass what's going to be a tax rate. Let's call this a state sales tax rate. And I'm just going to pass a constant, 0.07. And I'm going to put that into a variable called B underscore B for broadcast, right? Underscore tax rate. And then I'll broadcast it this way. I can retrieve the value of that variable by just using the value property. Now that we have the broadcast variable available here, I want to show you how you can use that in our next type of function, which is iterator of series to iterator of series. Don't get too confused here. The big difference between this particular function type versus the last one is we're now using iterators. The other thing we're also restricted by is that we can only pass one iterator in. We can't do multiple iterators in this particular format of a function. We're going to be importing from typing import iterator. From pandas, we're going to be bringing in, of course, the PD again. We're going to import pandas as PD. We're going to bring the PySpark SQL functions. We're going to bring in pandas UDF again. And notice our decorator this time is long. So we're telling Spark by doing that this will return a long type, which is a long integer type. Then we have a function definition, def, tax underscore UDF. Now notice it's a little different this time because now we say iterator, colon, iterator PD series. And notice now we have the type hint again, right? Iterator PD series again. So what this is saying is it's going to be taking an iterator in, right here, right? An iterator of a PD series or a column of a data frame. And it's going to be returning a series, an iterator of series. a series by itself is not an iterator. It's just a series. It's a column, essentially. So the previous function version was taking the entire column of data, basically, and just passing it through. In this case, it's not going to automatically just process that entire set of data. Instead, it's going to handle it in batches, and it's going to be using an iterator. So here we can do something. Because we need to initiate the iterator, we have a sort of space in here that we can now code other logic. So one of the things we can do is retrieve that tax rate that we broadcast earlier. So we're going to retrieve it and put it in tax rate, that variable. I'm going to get it by saying b_tax_rate.value, right? Because we broadcast it and we can return it or get it by going for the value property. Now that we have it, we can just start our iterator. For sales amount in iterator. Now what that's going to do is it's going to grab whatever we passed in this case our series, and it's going to grab each instance and plug it into a variable called sales amount. So every time it's going to grab something from the row coming in, plug it into sales amount. And it's going to just automatically keep doing that for us. We're going to do yield, which means this is our return. We're going to calculate the tax amount by taking the tax rate, right, the 0.07, and multiplying it by sales amount. So we'll get some amount. Now we can get the sales tax amount. I do want to point out that what you do here, and I took that comment, some expensive initialization, because depending on what you do, that could really bog down the Spark cluster. In a case like this, it's a single variable, shouldn't be too bad, but if you had, say, a 1,000 nodes cluster, and you suddenly tried to push out, you know, a terabyte data frame to the nodes, it probably would crash the cluster, etc. You have to be careful what you're doing when you do that initialization logic. And as before, I'm just doing another select. In this case, I'm just passing the name of the function, tax_UDF sales amount. And then here, what I wanted to show you is how do I rename that so I don't get that ugly tax UDF sales amount as a column name. I can just append alias to it and then give it a new name. Then I'm doing show. And here you can see all my values. You can see, okay, of the first sales, $250 was the tax. Next one was $237. So the big takeaway I want you to sort of see here is that in this case, one, we cannot pass two columns in as input. We're just passing one because it's an iterator of series, two iterator of series, meaning that's what it returns. The other thing, of course, in both of these examples, you've got to use this decorator to tell it what's going to come back. We're always going to be doing this type hint. This is the new sort of standard formatting. But in the iterator of series, the iterator formatting of the function allows us to do other logic before the function kicks in to actually process the series. That's the advantage of using an iterator, as we see here, because we have to say, okay, start using the iterator. The other thing is it should perform better in many cases over the regular series to series, because the iterator, according to the documentation at least, says it does prefetching of the row. So it's actually able to cache data ahead of time and start processing more efficiently. Now I want to kind of go back to our first example in terms of what it was doing. If you remember, it was calculating the margin percent or the profit margin based on sales and product cost. I want to do the same thing, but I want to use the iterator type of formatting because I think I can get some performance improvements and maybe I want to do some initialization logic. In this case, I'm not going to include initialization logic like with the broadcast variable, but I could because I'm using an iterator. They call that an iterator of multiple series to iterator of series, meaning that you can pass as many columns as you want in series, but you're going to get back one iterator back. Again, the key difference here from the first example is we're using iterators. So again, up here, we're going to be bringing, we're importing the iterator and the tuple from typing, and of course, pandas is PD, and again, as usual, getting the pandas UDF from PySpark SQL functions. So as we've seen, there's sort of a pattern here I hope you're catching on to. We're going to use the decorator. And there is another way to code this without using the decorator. I'm just showing you this way because personally, I think it's the easiest to read. And I think decorators are pretty cool. So I'm going with this. But there is another way you could code it. But we're saying it's going to be returning a double. And let's take a look at our function. Just as before, def margin percent, only here I'm calling it multi_iter_UDF because this is the multiple iterator. And here we have multiple series iterator. And here we have an iterator. And notice it's a tuple. When you use Python and you have multiple things coming back, typically it's a tuple, which is just a way of packaging columns. So we really have a tuple of series that's being passed in. which means we can pass as many columns from a data frame as we like. We just have to make room for them. So here we're saying, yes, we've got an iterator. It's of a tuple. And here's the columns. We've got two columns coming in. So we expect this to have two columns, which are going to automatically be formatted as a tuple. That's going to be returning an iterator of series. So let me just kind of walk through this again. What's being passed in is an iterator, right? An iterator of tuple. And it's going to have two series within it, two columns within it. And we're going to return an iterator of series back. And here's our iterator loop. The only difference here is, as before, we're saying for, and then we're going to give it like sales amount or some variable that we're going to be storing things in as we go through. But we've got two columns, right? We've got the sales amount and the product cost, because it's coming back for each tuple as we get through it. And it's going to be pulling that out of our iterator. And as we get each one of these, the return is going to be, or the yield, will be taking the sales amount less the product cost and dividing it by sales amount. So it's very similar to what we did in our first example. The only real difference is that now we're using iterators as opposed to just series. Let me run that. And I'm separating out our call so we can just kind of see that. That's a lot to take in. We can actually try it out. So we're going to again use our SPDF underscore sales. We're going to use the select method. We're going to ask to see the sales amount and the total product cost as we did in our first example before. And we're going to call margin percent multiple iter UDF. I know it's a long column name. And I'm not going to bother trying to use the alias on that. I'm just going to show it as is. But notice we're passing in the sales amount and the total product cost. So in many ways, it looks like the first example. But this should, I think, in most cases, perform better. And it gives us the opportunity to put in any kind of logic we would like in our function prior to doing the iteration. And you can see now we see our sales amounts and our product cost, and we can see our profit margin here. And as I said, it's just using the format of the function call as the column name. That was a lot to take in. And honestly, I think the example may not be the kind of example you're looking to do, but I wanted to keep it pretty simple because I found that everything I was looking for examples out there to find were either so simple, like just adding two numbers together, that it seemed useless, or examples that got into very complex machine learning algorithms and scaling out to massive sets of training models or something. And I just think that's a little too much when all you're trying to really understand is how do we code these functions. So in this video, we saw how to do a series to series. And this is the only one we saw that did not require iterators, right? We just had, we pass a series in, or we can even pass multiple series in, and we return a series back. A nice thing about it is it's really easy to code, and it lets you pass as many series as you want in. It's very simple, and it performs well. It's going to use arrow, and it should be perform well. But then we took a look at using iterators, iterator of series to iterator of series. And one of the big advantages of using this type of formatting of our code is it allows us to do some sort of initialization or extra logic prior to looping over our iterator. It also should perform well. The documentation especially talks a lot about prefetching data, and it can be used to sort of send out batches of processing when you're doing large data sets. So it should perform better in many cases, but the iterator of series is limited to a single series, a single column. So if you wanted to really get the same thing with iterators that we had in our first example, series to series, then you're going to use the format called iterator of multiple series to iterator of series. Very similar conceptually to the first example, but it used iterators and it allows us to do the initialization logic. So take a look at the notebook. You can go out and get it and bring it in and take a look at how that code works and feel free to, you know, kind of tweak it to what your needs are. As always, I put it a non-disclosure that you use the code as is. I'm not promising anything with it, but feel free to use the code and try to accommodate your requirements for this. And that's it for this video. Please like, share, subscribe, give me feedback in the comments. Let people know about my channel. I always ask that because the more I can get people to know, the more people can benefit from the training I'm doing. Until next time, I'm pulling for you. We're all in this together. Thank you.